Hello everyone. So today we will be starting with the second chapter, which is two-dimensional kinematics. So two-dimensional motion, I'll give you some examples of this kind of a motion. If I just move around in this room, like I was explaining in my first lecture, I just move around in this room, I'm moving in two dimension because I'm moving in X and I'm moving in Y. So the sides of this room, or the corners of this room, you can imagine them as if they form your XY coordinate system. I don't move up and down in this room, so the Z direction is not involved. This is my two-dimensional motion. You can see a car that is taking a circular turn. That's again a two-dimensional motion. You take a stone and throw it in the air. It follows a parabolic path. That's again a two-dimensional motion. So two-dimensional motion, it opens a whole lot new possibilities of motion that can be analyzed under this section. And that is why the concept of vectors, basically the concept of direction along with a magnitude, that becomes more relevant here. Not that the concept didn't exist in one-dimensional motion, it did exist. But the only difference was the motion was either forward or backward. So it's like you have your origin and the motion will either be on right hand side of it or it will be on towards left hand side of it. So that was the only two possibilities that were there in one-dimensional motion. Whereas in two-dimensional motion, you have your origin and your motion can be either up or down, or it can be rightward or leftward. So it opens a whole new lot of possibilities for this motion to happen, and that is why the concept of vectors, that is direction, where is the exact motion happening. For example, if you have your usual directions as north, east, west and south, then you have a few more directions such as northeast or northwest or southwest or southeast. So those many directions you have, but even these many directions are not sufficient to explain a motion completely. For example, if a particle is moving in this direction, it is neither north nor east nor is it northeast. It's something in between all that. So to explain such kind of a motion, we need a concept of vectors. So just try to recall which vectors we are already introduced to in the first chapter, that is 1D kinematics. You know, out of distance and displacement, you know, this was vector, whereas this was scalar, right? Then we had our, speed, where I only talked about the magnitude of how fast you are moving but did not explain anything about the direction. So it was definitely a scalar quantity. Whereas velocity, where I always talked about the direction of the motion, basically the positive or negative sign of the speed is what I was talking about. So that involved velocity, which is a vector. Then, probably you had acceleration. So that's again another vector. So these are the five quantities, of which two were scalars and three were vectors, which we were introduced to in the first chapter. But these are not the only quantities that we deal in physics. So we deal with work, we deal with torque, we deal with so many other quantities which can be either segregated into scalars or into vectors. So what are exactly scalars and vectors? In fact, I have already scratched the surface of this in the first chapter. You know, scalar quantities are the ones which only have their magnitude. For example, if I say a particle moves certain distance, I don't need to specify how much, I don't need to specify in what direction it has moved. The temperature in this room is 40 degrees Celsius, let us say. I don't need to specify the direction to it. So these are all scalar quantities that I am talking about. But if you talk about a velocity, you have to talk about in which direction is the particle moving. If you talk about a torque, the concept that you will come across in a rotation chapter. So basically, this pen is not going anywhere else, but it is just rotating about its own axis. So it's not moving in X or in Y or in Z direction. It's just where it is, but it is rotating. So this rotational motion, it is because of a terminology called as torque. So torque is a vector quantity. The angular velocity of this, like your velocity in linear dimensions or velocity in the, translational motion, this is a rotational motion. So it has something called as angular velocity. So that is again a vector quantity. So there are so many vector quantities that are involved. Basic difference between scalars and vectors is scalars, they have only magnitude. So how much is the only question that we ask when we talk about scalars. Whereas in case of vectors, we talk about how much, that is the magnitude, and we also talk about in what direction is it happening. So we talk about direction as well as magnitude. So that is a fundamental difference between your scalars and vectors. If we talk about only this chapter, that is motion in a plane, that is 2D kinematics, in that context, you know, the fundamental vector that you were already introduced in the first chapter is position. We talked about position versus time charts, but I never explained that it is a vector quantity. Remember, position is a vector quantity. Even if you talk about a position in one dimension, does not mean that position is vector when you talk about 2D and position is a scalar when you talk about 1D. It is not like that. Even in one dimension, your position was always a vector. So let me constrain first my motion to one dimension only. So the motion will happen in this direction or in this direction. Now, this is my origin. This is where the particle is or the body is. Now, how do I denote the position of this? Let us say the distance is 2 meter. So I used to say that the position of the particle is 2 meter. But then a particle which is at 2 meter could have been here as well, right? But that didn't happen. When I say 2 meter, I mean positive 2 meter. When I say minus 2 meter, then only the particle can lie here. That means position is a vector. So for expressing position, we draw a vector like this. So vector is basically a line with an arrowhead over it. That is a vector. So basically the length of the line, the length of this line, it denotes the magnitude. So length denotes the magnitude of the vector. Whereas this arrowhead, it denotes the direction. So how do we define a vector? Vector is a graphical representation of a physical quantity. Vector is a graphical representation of a physical quantity. What is the physical quantity right now being graphically represented? It is my position. Can I denote velocity by the same graphical representation? Yes, I can. Can I denote acceleration by the same graphical representation? Yes, I can. So vector is not some rocket science concept. It's just a graphical representation of your physical quantity. What do you need to specify such physical quantities? You need their magnitude, how big they are, and where they are directed. So it denotes both the things, how big they are and where they are directed. So it's just a graphical representation of the things happening. So as I said, position is a vector quantity. Now if it is a vector quantity in one dimension, it is a vector quantity in two dimensions as well. So in two dimensions, we have these two axes, motion happening along x and y. In three dimensions, you obviously know there is a third axis, which is z-axis. So it involves this way motion as well. But currently we are restricted or we are confining to a motion that is only on the plane of this whiteboard or only on the plane of your notebook. So that's a two-dimensional motion. In fact, that is why it is called as a motion in a plane. So this is a plane in which the motion will happen. Now, how do I denote my position vector when a 2D motion is happening? So let us say your initial position where the object is. Now the object won't lie on the axis necessarily. It can, but it will not necessarily lie on the axis. Because it's a two-dimensional motion, it can take a freedom of moving anywhere on the plane. And that is why this is where it is right now. This is its initial position. How do I denote it? If this is my origin, in fact this is my origin because that is where the x and y axis are meeting each other. In that case, this line denotes the magnitude of the position, basically the distance at which the particle is lying right now from the origin. That distance is denoted by the magnitude of this line, that is mean the length of the line. Now I put a arrowhead there. That completes my representation of a position of the object. So how is the position represented? It has this much magnitude. And how do I denote the direction? I will have to talk about the angle that it makes with the x-axis. So this is how a vector is represented. You give a magnitude, you put an arrowhead to show whether it is in this direction or this direction, and you give its angle with respect to any one of the axes. That is how you completely graphically represent a vector. Now this is my initial position vector. That means my object initially at time equal to 0, the object lies here. Let us say our object takes some path and reaches at this position at there. At point B is where object reaches at some time instant t. Now how do I represent this position of the object? I will represent it like this. Okay, so this is my initial position. B is my final position. Now how do I represent the displacement of the object? Try to recall the definition of the displacement that we have learned in our first chapter. The definition won't change. Displacement is defined as the change in the position of the object, where always in physics you have to remember change is final minus initial. So displacement is defined as final position minus initial position. So intuitively, can you guess how will the displacement vector look like? It will look like this, right? This is how your displacement vector will look like. And can you judge what is, if I measure the length of the path taken by the object, what will it be called? It will be called distance. And what is this vector denoting? It is denoting the displacement of the particle. Now, how do you get the magnitude and direction of that displacement? Because I am saying that displacement is a vector, which anyway was true in first chapter. It was already defined to be a vector quantity. So if displacement is a vector, I should tell its magnitude and I should tell its direction. So how do I measure this magnitude? How do I denote the direction of this vector if I am only given the initial position and final position? How do I do that? Will be covered in further section when we learn about adding and subtracting the vectors. But let me give you an example which you already know. Let us consider your displacement only in one dimension. Let us take our previous example where only 1D motion is there. So you have O as a origin, you have A as the initial position of the object, and the object moves only along this straight line and reaches B. Okay, with the logic that I have already told you how to denote a position vector, how will its initial position vector look like? OA, right, is what is its initial position vector. So initial position vector is OA bar, right, where OA bar denotes the direction as well as the magnitude of its initial position. What is the final position? It is OB bar, right? So O to B bar, right? Let me denote this arrow here to have a better clarity. This is my OA bar and this is my OB bar. It starts from O and ends at B. Now if I ask you, tell me how much is the displacement? The answer should be very simple. The displacement is the difference between OB and OA. And what is the direction of it? It is in the same direction as that of OB or OA. So how do I write? Displacement is equal to OB bar minus OA bar. That means final position vector minus initial position vector is your displacement. Now can you not apply the same logic while defining the displacement in two dimensions? What I mean is, this was your A position, this is your B position, right? It took some random path in between. Now O to A is your initial position vector, O to B is your final position vector. Now OA is initial position vector, OB is initial final position vector. How is displacement indicated? It is this. So it is AB bar. Now how do I give AB bar? I will use the same formula. The displacement AB bar can be represented as OA bar So rather OB bar minus OA bar. That is how we can give our displacement. But the only difference between 1D situation and 2D situation is that in 1D, you could have easily subtracted the two because both are in the same direction. You can just subtract their magnitudes and get the displacement. If you have this as 5 meter and this as 2 meter, you can get that the total displacement is 3 meter in the right one direction. In here, you cannot do that because OA vector is in some other direction, OB vector is in some other direction. So you cannot directly subtract them. Then there are some rules of adding and subtracting the vectors. We will have to look into those rules. But that is how position and displacement vectors work in two dimensions. Now, let us consider something as equality of the two vectors. The terminology is very simple. If you have two vectors and their magnitude and the direction, that means the angle, are the same. So both have length L and both have angle theta, then the vectors are called as equal vectors. So that is what equality of vectors. Now multiplication of these vectors with real numbers, that gives us some interesting things. So real numbers, you have any number, an integer or a fraction. If you multiply that number with a vector, how do we represent a vector? Let us say this is my vector A bar. If I multiply it with a real number, so let us say if I multiply it with small a, where a is a real number, then I get a vector whose magnitude is equal to a, that is small a times magnitude of vector a. As simple as that, but the direction stays same. How do we denote the magnitude of a vector? This is the notation for, you know, denoting the magnitude of a vector, where these two bars, they are called as mod. So you take a mod of a vector, basically magnitude of a vector. This is how it is indicated. So you multiply a certain vector by a scalar number. If you multiply it with a real number, what is the total magnitude of that vector? It is A times magnitude of A. So magnitude of this is equal to A times magnitude of A. Direction remains the same. So it just gets magnified. Let us say I have a vector A bar. And if I multiply it with 2, then the ultimately vector that I will be getting will be twice its length, but in the same direction. So the vector that I will get is of length 2L, but in the same direction. If I multiply it with 3, then it will be a vector in the same direction of thrice the magnitude. That is what multiplication of vectors with real numbers mean. Now, that leads us to the next concept, which is concept of unit vector. So, unit vector is given as a vector in the same direction as that of our original vector, but of magnitude 1 unit. For example, A bar is your vector. Now, unit vector is the vector which is in the same direction, but its magnitude is only 1 unit. That is how a unit vector is defined. That means the formula for unit vector will go something like this. Unit vector, it is denoted by u cap, is given as A bar divided by magnitude of A bar. Suppose, let us take for example that A bar is a vector of magnitude 2 units. So, unit vector would be that A bar vector divided by 2. That will give me a unit vector in this direction. For example, if it is a vector at 60 degree with x axis, then unit vector will also be in 60 degree with x axis, but its magnitude will be only 1. So this is a formula to give your unit vector, a vector of magnitude 1. Now there are unit vectors which are, you know, considered standard ones. So unit vector along x direction is called as I cap. Unit vector along x direction, which is a vector of magnitude 1 unit but in x direction, A vector which is in y direction and of magnitude 1 unit is called j cap. A unit vector which is in z direction and of magnitude 1 unit is called as k cap, which we will not be dealing with right now because this is a two-dimensional motion. So I cap and j cap are the two notations. This is called cap. So I cap and j cap are the two notations that we will be using for denoting one unit vector in x direction or in y direction. Okay. Let us learn how to express a vector. Now there are two forms in which we can express a vector. One form, that is the first form, is a polar form, whereas the second form is called as Cartesian form. So the first form is polar form, which is familiar to you. So in this form we give the vector as r theta combination. Basically we were representing the vector for so much time in this polar form, which is r theta form. So you give the magnitude of the vector, which is r. So if your vector is r bar, its magnitude of the vector is equal to r, some number. So let us say your vector has a magnitude of unit 2 units. So r will stand for 2 in here. Whereas theta is the angle to which the vector is inclined with x axis or y axis. In this case the vector is inclined at 30 degrees to x axis. So we will give this vector as 2, 30 degree. That means the vector has a magnitude of 2 units and an angle of 30 degree. This is one way of expressing a vector. Now why am I telling you all this? Because when you want to add the vector, subtract the vector, multiply the vectors, probably in future we'll be multiplying the vectors also. So for all these vector operations, you should first know how to write a vector or how to represent a vector. So this is one form in which you can express your vector. Second form in which you can express your vector is Cartesian form. So Cartesian form of vector representation, it needs first the basics of trigonometry. And so in Cartesian form, we will first see what is the use of trigonometry in here. So trigonometry is mathematical terminology used for defining the or relating the sides of a triangle with its angles. So let us say this is a triangle in which this side is r. The length of this side is r, basically the hypotenuse of a right angle triangle. The length of this side is a, whereas the length of this side is b. All have same units, probably centimeter, 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 meter, 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 millimeter, millimeter, millimeter. All in same units. If you have such kind of a triangle, and let us say this angle, any one of the two angles you can call it theta. I am representing this angle between r and b as theta, whereas the other angle, this angle, is 90 degree angle. This angle will obviously be 90 minus theta degree. Now in such case, our trigonometry, it defines three important functions: sin theta, cos theta and tan theta, where sin, cos, tan are the functions that are defined in trigonometry. These functions are operated on this angle theta. So when a function called sin is operated on this angle theta, it is defined as opposite side divided by hypotenuse in the triangle. So what is the opposite side in here? The length of opposite side is a, divided by the length of the hypotenuse in here is r, and that is why our sin theta will stand for a over r. Now how is cos theta defined in here? So cos theta, that is cosine function. So this is a sine function, this is cosine function. Short form for cosine function is cos. So when cosine function is operated on this angle theta, we get it as a ratio of adjacent side of this angle to hypotenuse. So which is adjacent side to angle theta? This is the adjacent side. This is the opposite side. And this is the hypotenuse. Right? So side that is adjacent to angle theta is b over hypotenuse is r. Now tan theta, you see, is the ratio of sine and cos theta. So sine theta by cos theta, basically the ratio of opposite side to adjacent side is your tan of theta. What is opposite side? It is a. The length of opposite side is A. The length of adjacent side is B. So the ratio of A over B is your tan of theta. Now this sine theta and cos theta, we can use them to, you know, define the horizontal component and vertical component of our vector. Suppose you have a vector R bar and you want to find its component in x direction and y direction. Okay. So your x direction component of this vector, so I am currently representing in which form? It is a polar form because there is a vector magnitude and there is a direction represented by angle theta. Its x component, that is component along x axis, can be given. You just compare this triangle and this figure. Your x component, that is in this case side B, which is adjacent to the angle theta, it can be given using this formula. B stands for, if I just take this R on this side, B will be equal to R cos of theta, and therefore it gives me B, which is in this case my x component of the vector, given as R cos of theta. A, which is y component of the vector, so this is A, it is given as, using this formula, A is R times sine of theta. So R cos theta and R sin theta are respectively its x and y components. Now the two vector together we can represent in I cap and j cap form. The I cap and j cap, as explained earlier, they are the unit vectors along x and y directions. So we can express this entire vector as R cos theta into I cap plus R sin theta into j cap. Okay. So this is the way we can represent one vector.